Good morning. A very warm welcome to the 10th meeting of the Constitution Europe External Affairs and Culture Committee in 2023. One agenda item this morning and one in private. So can I have a decision to take agenda item 3 in private, please? Thank you very much. A second agenda item is to continue to take evidence on an inquiry into how devolution is changing post-EU and how devolution should evolve to respond to the challenges and opportunities of the new constitutional landscape. And we're joined this morning by Professor Aileen McCarg, Professor of Public Law, Human Rights at Durham University. Good morning and welcome to committee. Thank you very much for providing your written evidence to the committee as well. And I know you've highlighted a number of ways in which the legal and constitutional framework for devolution could be strengthened. I just wondered if you had any priority areas in the suggestions you've made and what you see as perhaps the biggest challenge going forward.
I suppose two priority areas. As other witnesses this committee have identified, strengthening the Seoul Convention is really fundamental, because unless there is some protection for the devolved institutions against the unilateral exercise of Westminster sovereignty, then there is no guarantees of anything. Now, there's a limit to how strong the constitutional guarantees one can provide within the current constitutional settlement, but we need to try and get back to the situation we were in pre-Brexit, where, yes, parliamentary sovereignty existed still in principle, but its operation in practice was constrained. So I think that is really, you know, fundamental. But the second area of priority, and this is something that increasingly concerns me, is simply the increased complexity of the devolution framework. Now, it was always complex, so we mustn't exaggerate what's happened here. There were always a number of different types of constraints on competence, which operated in different ways. They were always difficult to understand for the uninitiated and even for the initiated. I mean, the as you will all be aware, the competence limits in Schedule 5 of the Scotland Act, for instance, are complex and always have been, and understanding exactly what they mean is not easy. But since Brexit, that picture has become a lot more complicated, particularly because of the new internal market framework. Also, to some extent, because of the new external trade framework, although that's much more difficult to do anything about. But the way in which the new internal market framework interacts with the devolution statutes, I think, is highly problematic. And that would be an area that I think would be worth trying to address and trying to simplify.
And thank you for that. In terms of the Seoul Convention, a lot of what we've covered is about intergovernmental relations. Do you see the stresses on the Seoul Convention being a fundamental issue, or do you think that the personalities involved in the government relations at the moment may have an influence on what happens going forward with regards to Seoul?
Well, I mean, I have seen it suggested that one way to strengthen the Seoul Convention is just to start respecting it again. And of course, that is true on one level, but that doesn't provide you with any guarantees against a further, you know, swing back in future. So I think that is probably not going to reassure anyone enough that things will change. But also, I think one of the big problems with the fact that the UK Parliament has acted without consent, for the first time the UK government has exercised its Section 33 reference powers, for the first time it's exercised its Section 35 veto power, for the first time, you know, it becomes much easier to do it for the second time. So once you've established a precedent, it becomes much more difficult, I think, to stop resort to those powers in future. So I think, again, to indicate a reset, I think it's not enough just to say, oh, well, you know, we won't use them, promise. We need to do something more formal to provide a reassurance that things will change.
Thank you. I'm going to move to questions from the committee, and I can invite Mr. Cameron first.
So thank you for that. My question was on the back of something the convener asked, and you went into this a little in your answer, which is to get your views on whether you think the problems that we've identified have always been there. They've been incubated since devolution, but Brexit has kind of thrown an intensity into the system. That's my first question, if you've got any further observations on that. And my second question was on Section 35, which you mentioned in your submission. And I think we know, as we all realise, that has actually nothing to do with Brexit, but it's just something that has been come to the fore in the recent months over the Gender Recognition Reform Bill. The committee heard evidence from Professor Jim Gallagher about this 2 weeks ago, and he said, when referring to Section 35, and I quote, "It is there because devolved legislative power is writ very wide." And he went on to say, "The test of devolved competence is wide because it involves anything that does not relate to reserve matter. Therefore, there is," and I quote, "a real possibility that devolved legislation would have a material effect on law in relation to reserve matters, but still not be reserved. So some kind of safety net was inevitable." What's your response to that? Do you agree with him?
Okay, I'll take your questions in order. So have these problems always existed? Have they always been latent in the system? I think the answer to that is yes. We know that devolution was enacted in the context of the continuing sovereignty of the Westminster Parliament. There were various powers written into the settlement. It's highly asymmetric, so you are subject to limits that the UK institutions are not subject to. However, there was a real ambiguity in the initial settlement, because you had the legal position on the one hand, and you had a political narrative on the other hand, which was, the Sewell Convention was very, very important. Yes, sovereignty exists, but it won't be exercised except with consent, normally, whatever normally means. We have these powers, but they're nuclear options. We really don't want to, we don't want to have to use them if we can absolutely avoid it. So you had this dual narrative. Now, devolution also takes place in the context of a range of other constitutional reforms introduced by the new Labour government, which also put parliamentary sovereignty under pressure. So you see in the period, particularly from around about 2000 onwards, you see the idea of sovereignty really coming under pressure. Does sovereignty really continue to exist in its current form? Will it eventually have to give way to this new constitutional reality? In various different ways. So you have the idea of constitutional statutes. Scotland Act is a constitutional statute, can't be impliedly repealed, for instance. Various other things. So sovereignty is under pressure, not just from, but including from devolution. So you've got a very kind of ambiguous situation. You might call it a constructive ambiguity, a deliberate abeyance in the constitution, a deliberate constitutional silence over what exactly this new development, this constitutional development means. Now, what we saw with Brexit is really just a kind of sweeping aside of all that ambiguity and a reassertion of parliamentary sovereignty, but not just in its traditional form. Actually, one of the very interesting things in the courts is the way in which sovereignty has been extended during the past few years. So we've really had a kind of reversion to a traditional understanding of the constitution with bells on, and that places the devolved institutions in a very precarious position. So I think Brexit has been an important change to answer that question. So Section 35, you said that its use in relation to the Gender Recognition Reform Bill was nothing to do with Brexit. Well, yes and no. Okay, so no, of course, not directly. The Gender Recognition Reform Bill is nothing directly to do with Brexit. But one of the things I identified in my submission was the indirect effects of Brexit. So one of the indirect effects of Brexit has been a resurgence of what some people call muscular unionism or assertive unionism. And I think we have to see the use of the Section 35 order very much in that context. I mean, it's very difficult to believe, it's impossible to believe, that there was no situation, no legislation passed by Holyrood or any of the other devolved parliaments in the preceding two decades that didn't have a knock-on effect on reserved law. But we know that those kind of knock-on effects were dealt with in different ways. They were dealt with through Section 104 orders, for instance. In some cases, dealt with through UK primary legislation. So that gets on to your final question. Is Section 35 an inevitable safety net? Well, one thing that's worth bearing in mind is it's not the same under the three devolution statutes. Right, it operates completely differently in relation to the Northern Ireland Assembly. There is it's not the presiding officer in that case who refers a bill for royal assent, it's the Secretary of State, and there's a different set of restrictions on when the Secretary of State can recommend the withholding of consent. It's different again under the Government of Wales Act. So is it necessary? Well, I think the fact that it's not the same might tell you something important. But I think there are almost always other things that can be done or should be done to avoid the necessity for the use of a Section 35 veto power. And what I worry about, I think the Gender Recognition Reform Bill falls into this category. What I worry about is that it can be used simply for policy reasons, right? Because often there will be these kind of knock-on consequences. And the choice not to deal with those knock-on consequences in some other way, but to veto, I think, in this context, has to be seen in the light of that policy difference that's there in relation to gender self-ID. And I also think, I mean, it's worth saying that the Gender Recognition Reform Bill was a great context for the first use of Section 35 because it's such a controversial bill. I can't imagine, if gender recognition reform had not been controversial within Scotland, I can't imagine that Section 35 would have been used. So it's, you know, that there was an opportunity, I think, there for first use of this power, and that opportunity was taken. And it was taken late in the day. I don't think it was on anyone's radar until relatively late in the day. And then it becomes preferred option. Because, you know, for most of the time, what opponents were talking about was seeking judicial review, was challenging the bill in the courts. Section 35 really only came to light as a possibility relatively late in the process.
Thank you. I think Dr. Allen's got a supplementary, and I'll bring you back in, Donald. So.
Thank you, convener. Donald has rightly said that devolved power is writ pretty wide. I suppose my question is about Section 35 powers themselves. Are they so broadly phrased as to be writ pretty wide as well? I don't know if you have any view about how that clause, the Governor General clause, as it was called at the time, is phrased and what latitude it gives to ministers in the UK and what latitude it might give to hypothetical ministers who might see themselves in a governor-general type role. I mean, I'm not quite sure what you feel about the actual phrasing of that section of the Scotland Act and whether you feel it's general in the way it's phrased.
Well, it's not available for use in all circumstances. And, you know, you've probably seen as well as I have done people asking for Section 35 to be invoked right, left and centre. It's not available generally against devolved legislation. It's only available in a limited range of circumstances. Now, in relation to the particular part that was used in relation to the Gender Recognition Reform Bill, this is for devolved legislation which modifies the law as it operates in relation to reserve matters and has adverse effects on the operation of the law. Now, there's two areas of ambiguity. What does it mean to... What kinds of laws are caught by that is not entirely clear, and it would be worth clarifying, in my view. But the other issue is what standard of review would the courts use if this, the use of a Section 35 order in either this case or the other two situations, which is impact on international obligations or national security, if that were challenged, what standard of review would a court adopt? And that's difficult to know, because you can see different kinds of considerations in play. You know, on the one hand, a court might say, this is high politics, this is relations between between political institutions, we should be really wary of intervening here. That might be one approach they take. But at the other extreme, they might say, this is an executive actor using a power to veto or at least require reconsideration of primary legislation passed by a democratically elected legislature, and therefore we should scrutinise that decision very carefully. Now, as I say, you can see both sets of arguments being made, and both sets of considerations are valid. And so where a court would land on the standard review question is also difficult to predict.
Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Cameron?
Thanks. I mean, I have to say I don't agree with you when it comes to your view that Section 35 is indirectly to do with Brexit. I just don't accept that. I don't think it has anything to do with Brexit at all. And also, I think you're making a lot of assumptions about the use of Section 35 in the gender recognition reform, but which I again don't accept. Can I ask you about something else? And that is the Scottish Government's keeping pace power. As you know, the Scottish Government has a stated policy of keeping pace with EU law, aligning with EU law. And I just wondered if you had any observations about the effects of that policy in a kind of post-Brexit world where the UK government has, at this stage, very much taken the opposite view.
So as far as I'm aware, the keeping pace power has not been used. I was quite critical before your predecessor committee of the keeping pace power when the bill was being considered, because there are problems in conferring those kind of powers on ministers. But there are obviously problems about the opportunities for divergence in the current constitutional landscape. The Scottish Government and Scottish Parliament, whether acting through primary legislation or secondary legislation, always has to be mindful of the effects of its ability effectively to diverge from UK legislation. So it's not about whether it can do so legally. Yes, it can. But can it make that policy or that legislation practically effective? And in situations where the UK government decides to take a different line for England, it is often going to be very difficult for the Scottish Parliament, Scottish ministers, Welsh Parliament and Welsh ministers to effectively maintain a different policy, whether that's a policy to keep pace with EU law or to diverge in some other way. So I don't think there's anything peculiar or special to the keeping pace power, but there is a general problem about the ability to effectively diverge in many situations. It won't be in every situation because a lot will depend on the precise market you're trying to intervene in and the state of trade and you know, the balance between local producers and imports and so on. But very often it is going to be problematic.
Thank you. Thank you, Camille.
Thank you. I'm going to bring in Ms. Boyack, please.
Thanks very much, Convener. Can I thank Professor McHarg for the paper you sent us? It's really helpful because it went into detail. It made you think beyond the headlines. There was a couple of issues I thought were really interesting I'd like to explore about reforming the devolution statutes. It's kind of to follow on from Donald Cameron's questions. And it was prompted partly because we had the Saxon State Parliament Constitution Committee with us this week, and obviously they have a legal constitution, but intergovernmental framework, a mediation committee, horizontal devolution. It's interesting to see their framework. And looking at your suggestion about a fuller set of principles to guide the interpretation of limits and devolved competence, you say there's arguments for and against. But I was very interested in your issues, which could potentially add clarity, the principle of subsidiarity, clarification of the extent of primary legislative competence under reserve powers. And then the third point was principles of union. Be interested. You said it could go the other way, but I would just think when we pass legislation, you've got a policy memorandum. What ministers say on the floor of the parliament can be interpreted by judges. So is there something about being really clear about what the intent of devolution is, and you know, to reinforce the importance of devolution given the experiences we've had post-Brexit?
So the approach that the UK courts have adopted, at least in relation to Scotland and Wales, it's a little less clear in relation to Northern Ireland, but at least in relation to Scotland and Wales, the approach is to treat the devolution statutes in the same way as any other statute. So the main focus is on the words of the statute understood in their context. The courts have largely, but not entirely consistently, eschewed the idea that they should read in additional interpretive principles or understandings of what these statutes mean. Now, that's an approach which is justified on the basis that it is most predictable and that it preserves the impartiality of the courts when they're dealing with conflicts between Westminster and a devolved legislature. That's the main justifications. Now, it's an approach which works well if the devolution statutes are only amended in a consensual manner, right? If the restrictions that are in the devolution statutes have been put in there following a considered process with the agreement of both UK and devolved governments and legislatures, that approach is defensible. But once that consensual development of the devolution statutes breaks down, it becomes an approach which inherently favours Westminster. And we saw that very, very clearly illustrated in the Continuity Bill reference. If you remember, after the bill had been referred to the Supreme Court, but before the Supreme Court decision was made, the Scotland Act was amended without the consent of this Parliament in a way which rendered a bill which had been largely within competence now became largely out with competence. And because all the court was doing was looking at the words of the statute, there was no sort of pushback or defence that the court could offer against that shifting of the goalposts. And it was a shifting of the goalposts. The other issue in recent years has been the use that the Supreme Court has made of Section 28.7 of the Scotland Act. As you know, that says the power of Westminster to continue to make laws for Scotland is unaffected, which we used to think was a purely declaratory provision, had no significance at all. But according to the Supreme Court in the Continuity Bill reference and then in the UNCRC and European Charter of Local Self-Government references, that acts as an additional constraint on devolved competence. Now, it's very difficult to understand how the court gets to that position. But it seems to be relying on what it says it shouldn't be doing, which is the reading in of things that are not there in the Scotland Act. Now, one of the difficulties is, say in the UNCRC case, what the court objected to was this Parliament trying to impose interpretive duties on UK legislation in devolved areas. Now, there's no doubt that this Parliament can repeal UK legislation in devolved areas or amend UK legislation in devolved areas. So it's kind of difficult to understand why you shouldn't be able to say, well, we want the courts to read UK legislation differently. It's an amendment process by a different route, in effect. But the court wasn't prepared to allow that and seemed to be relying on the reading in of a non-delegation doctrine into the Scotland Act. It doesn't say so explicitly, but that seems to be what's going on there. So the courts are not consistent in this approach, which purely relies on the wording of the statute. They do have a set of background constitutional principles in mind. They also, you may remember the AXA case, it held in that case that the Supreme Court held in that case that at common law, Holyrood was subject to certain constitutional constraints, rule of law constraints and human rights constraints. So there is some supplementing going on, but it's a set of constitutional assumptions or principles or values which are not specifically tailored to devolution. So what I'm suggesting is that it may now be necessary to require the courts to pay attention to the specific constitutional context and requirements of effective devolved lawmaking. So again, if we go back to the UNCRC case, for instance, that the Supreme Court was very concerned in that case about maintaining the effectiveness of Parliament's, the UK Parliament's ability to legislate in devolved areas, free from any kind of constraints, political constraints or whatever, imposed by the devolved legislatures. But it didn't have any concern, apparent concern, for the effectiveness of this Parliament's lawmaking. Now, in the context of the UNCRC case, if you limit the application of the UNCRC just to devolved legislation affecting children, you're missing out large parts of the devolved statute book. So you're creating a really problematically patchworky approach. So that concern for good devolved lawmaking was absent from the Supreme Court's decision. Continuity Bill's reference, similarly, the court objected to this Parliament trying to impose a consent requirement on UK ministers when making delegated legislation in devolved areas. Again, it saw that in terms of placing limits on the effective exercise of the UK Parliament's legislative competence. That's not really what it was about. It was about ministerial lawmaking, right? Ministerial lawmaking is not sovereign. It's about the ability of the devolved institutions to try to maintain some control over what happens in the devolved policy space. And as you know, you made this point in your previous reports, the ability of this Parliament to have any kind of scrutiny function in relation to UK ministerial powers is entirely dependent on the quality of consent or consultation required with the Scottish ministers. So again, no concern for good governance at the devolved level. So that's that's what's motivating those recommendations that I made. That I think the courts need to be forced to take account of good governance at the devolved level and not see devolution purely through a kind of traditional Westminster-centric constitutional lens.
Can I maybe ask a supplementary just before we move on? Is that okay?
I was going to come back on the same issue.
Right, you go first.
Sorry. So to go back to your recommendation, the process of how you would do that, would you see legislation being passed by the UK Parliament to enact the principles you've identified in the paragraph or referred to, the principle of subsidiarity, clarification on the extent of plenary legislative competence? So you had a principled approach and a set of principles of union to clarify that devolved parliaments would have competence and be clear about that. So when courts were considering it, it was a piece of legislation that actually framed this and updated the devolution principles. Mm-hmm. So it would be partly about the Scotland Act, but it would also apply right across the piece. It would apply to Wales, it would apply to Northern Ireland as well. And then when courts were considering it, it would be a clear piece of legislation that had been moved by the UK Parliament, but also supported by all the other devolved parliaments at the same time.
Yeah. I mean, that's the thinking. Now, there's no guarantee with an approach like this, okay, that mm-hmm. when you create broad interpretive principles, they still have to be interpreted by courts. The courts still have to decide what kind of weight or relevance they're going to give them, and they may not interpret them in the way that you anticipate. But I don't think that there's any hope of reorienting the approach taken by the Supreme Court without legislative intervention, at least not in the current the way things are at the moment. The Supreme Court, as I said earlier, has since Brexit reverted very much to a traditional understanding of the Constitution. And therefore, I think it will only respond to clear statutory directions from Westminster.
Okay, thank you. I might want to come back later, but over to you, Convener.
Absolutely, thank you. I wonder if I could just ask, because you mentioned a couple of times about the institution of the Parliament importance in this, but what we see is the court cases tend to be about government policy issues and you know, bills going through here. But the commentary there has been some commentary, particularly from Lord McFall, about the nature of us sleepwalking into legislative, sort of like the control being within the government and the use of secondary legislation has raised concerns about those. But is there a wider issue about how the devolved parliaments should be taking a role, and maybe who is the person who should be protecting the nature of the Scotland Act as it stands at the moment? And are there any mechanisms available to the Parliament, through the presiding officer, through the committees of the Parliaments, that maybe we haven't used to full advantage in exploring some of these issues until now?
So do you mean in terms of preventing the Scottish Government from taking too many powers?
Well, both in terms of obviously you talked about the nature of some of the decisions that were taken at government level. Does the Parliament have a role in sort of protecting the devolution settlements, if you like, or a voice or a mechanism for actually influencing what's happening if we move forward to change this? Does it have to be the government's leading on this at the moment? Is there any other way we could be doing this?
Well, I mean, one criticism that's been made of Holyrood, certainly, I don't know to what extent it applies to the other parliaments, is that the policing of the devolution settlement was very much a bureaucratic process. So done by government lawyers, in consultation with parliamentary lawyers, in consultation with UK government lawyers. And what you get at the end of it is a statement, you know, this bill is compatible or in one case only from the presiding officer, one government bill, that it's not compatible. So, I mean, there could be a role for this parliament in interrogating those kind of competence statements more fully, but those competence statements themselves would have to become fuller and better reasoned. But there is a precedent at UK level. You might think about an analogy with the Joint Committee on Human Rights, which scrutinises statements under Section 19 of the Human Rights Act that Westminster bills are compatible or not compatible with the Convention. So the committee actually takes evidence and publishes reports on whether it agrees with the government's statement. So there certainly could be a bigger role for the Parliament. The House of Lords Constitution Committee also plays that sort of role, and of course this committee does too. But with all these things, there's always going to be a capacity issue, and I think that's a common challenge for this Parliament, that you are stretched. I noted that Nicola McKeown in your last session suggested that you should be larger, and I would agree with that, actually. I think there is a case for increasing the number of MSPs, particularly since competences have expanded. Necessarily, those require more resources to ensure that they are properly exercised.
Thank you. Thank you. Can I bring in Mr. Golden, please?
Thank you, Convener. In reading your submission, you've made a number of recommendations regarding reforms you'd like to see to the Internal Market Act, including statutory grounds on which market access principles can be disapplied. You've also suggested there's no reason in principle why devolved primary legislation should be subject to the subsidy control principles when UK primary legislation is not. So my question is, can the reforms you suggested be done in a way that maintains the Internal Market Act market access principles of mutual recognition and equal access to the same degree they are currently enshrined? Or by implementing these changes, would there be a degree of watering down these principles and in turn could impact the ability of Scottish businesses to trade freely and fairly with the rest of the UK?
Well, I mean, I think if you increase the opportunity for departure from the market access principles, yes, necessarily you are watering them down, if you want to use that language. But I mean, the curiosity about the UK Internal Market Act is it's much, much stricter than the EU rules that it replaced. I've never seen or heard a justification for why that is the case. Why suddenly, in the post-Brexit environment, does trade need to be protected so much more strongly against other non-market objectives? There's always a balance to be struck here. And this seems to, the bill embodies a policy choice for unrestricted free trade over other types of regulatory objectives. Except, of course, it doesn't necessarily, because you have an exemption process. Okay, so it is possible for the market access principles to be disapplied on an ad hoc basis, but that's unpredictable. It's a process which is very strongly controlled by the UK government, with limited input from the devolved administrations. So it's not that the UK Internal Market Act prevents divergence or prevents a balance being struck between free market, free trade and other objectives. It just passes that to the discretion of UK ministers.
Thanks for that. And in your submission, you also mentioned exemptions. And There's previously been one exemption under single-use plastics, and that process took 5 months to conclude. There's now a more complicated exemption process around the Scottish Deposit Return Scheme. Can you think of any reason why, given it is more complicated and therefore might take longer to come to a conclusion, why the Scottish Government waited till 5 months before the launch date of the scheme to formally ask for an exemption?
I have no insight into the decision-making process around the deposit return scheme. The process for formal request of an exemption is, of course, not a statutory process. It's a process which sits within the Common Frameworks process. So I don't know at what point that procedure was formalised or how widely known it is. And there's always a problem, isn't there, of things that are not contained in statutes in terms of accessibility and transparency and intelligibility. So maybe those were considerations. There may still be some uncertainty about whether an exemption would be required. These rules don't operate, the Internal Market Act rules, again, they don't operate in the same way as the EU rules operated. We're in a new, complicated, uncertain situation. And so that level of uncertainty may have been a factor as well. But I don't know.
Okay. Thanks.
But I think if I could just add on that, I mean, there is an interesting point about this exemption process. You say single-use plastics, yes, it took a long time, that's one objection to it, but it's also really restrictive. Instead of exempting single-use plastic products as a category, it exempts a specified list of products. And as you know, people out there are constantly coming up with new inventive uses for single-use plastics. You're constantly chasing your tail on this, constantly having to go through the same process, even though the principles at stake might well be the same. On deposit return, Alistair Jack has been reported as saying the threshold for granting an exemption is a very high bar. Is it? The statute doesn't say so. The statute's entirely permissive. So you've got, a UK government minister deciding that the threshold for grant of an exemption is a high one. A different minister might take a completely different view, in a different context, depending on their view of the merits of the exemption being sought. So,
thanks. And just as a follow-up to that, again, in your submission, you mentioned that if the UK government declines to make an exemption around deposit return, it would be very difficult to challenge that decision. I just wondered what processes the Scottish government might use to challenge that decision, if any are available.
So there's a dispute resolution procedure in the Common Frameworks process, which, as far as I'm aware, hasn't yet been used. There's also dispute resolution procedures generally under the new intergovernmental relations machinery. Again, I'm not aware that those have been invoked yet. So there's informal political dispute resolution mechanisms as yet untested. And then there's judicial mechanisms. It is possible, of course, always to seek judicial review of a decision, but it's harder to judicially review the exercise of a power that is so broad in its specification. So it's very, the broader a power, a discretion is, of course, the harder it is to challenge that. I had a look at the relevant common framework, which is Waste and Resources, I think, which is still a draft common framework, and that does refer to deposit return schemes as one area where divergence might be expected. But it's very, very vaguely worded. And it wouldn't be enough, I don't think, to found a claim for legitimate expectations, for instance, which might be a possibility in other contexts. So, yes, it's just good. It's difficult to see how you would mount an effective legal challenge to the failure to exercise a discretionary power. And as I say, the other non-legal dispute resolution mechanisms are as yet untested.
Thank you. That's very helpful. Back to you, Convener.
Mr. Ruskell.
Yeah, if I could just stay on that issue of Internal Market Act exemptions. I think evidence we've taken in Parliament and other committees has suggested that the discussion within the common framework on deposit return scheme has been ongoing for a long period of time. But I wonder to what extent you think that that whole process should be codified and made potentially more transparent to all parliaments to see exactly what the nature has been of those discussions, or whether you think that that would impact in some way on the nature of the common framework, because the common framework seems to be led largely by civil servants. There is ministerial engagement within that, but it's a very evidence-based process. So do you see like a codification of that exemption process as having an impact on common frameworks?
So common frameworks, as I understand them, have not been used in the way that we might have expected them to be used. So I think they were envisaged as a sort of a harmonisation process. So that would be the context in which you would decide when it was necessary to have a common set of rules and when divergence was acceptable. And then on top of that, you know, then into that consensual negotiated sort of harmonisation process, you had the UK Internal Market Act kind of plonked on top. And my impression is that sort of derailed the common frameworks, because it then became unclear what was really the point of the common frameworks. And so, you know, they are all a lot vaguer and more sort of process-oriented rather than substantive than they might otherwise have been. Could you make them more formal? I mean, so one way in which I suggested they could be made more formal is that if there were an agreement to diverge in a common framework, then instead of that being a ground on which an exemption might be granted, it could become mandatory, right? But at that point, then decision making in the common framework process becomes much more important, and those issues you've raised about transparency and participation and so on become much more important. So I think, yeah, any degree of formalisation would raise concerns about, if you like, shadow or parallel lawmaking. But that's in the nature of any kind of intergovernmental process. I mean, those kind of concerns about accessibility, participation, transparency, accountability, those are inherent to intergovernmental negotiations, and they are inherently difficult to address.
Do you feel that with common frameworks that there is potentially a shift towards more executive power and less transparency? I'm speaking in general terms about how common frameworks have operated up to now, and particularly in areas which were previously European Union competencies, where perhaps there might have been more stakeholder engagement and long processes of policy formulation, whereas now potentially it's more between governments to make decisions.
I mean, I'm not sufficiently up on the detail of individual common frameworks to say whether that's true or not. And we're only really beginning to see the practical implications of this whole post-Brexit internal market framework play out in relation to particular decisions. So it might, you know, I think maybe too early to tell, but I can't really provide any fuller answer on that, sorry.
Okay, my last question was about an area which we've taken quite a lot of evidence on, that's retained EU law. So I don't know if you have any comments more generally on that bill, but I did want to ask you specifically within your area of expertise around human rights, if you felt there were any potential unintended or even intended consequences as a result of the law and the December the 23rd cliff edge.
Well, the general principles of EU law are disapplied by the retained EU law bill. So those, as you probably know, in EU law, human rights operate on two levels. They operated via the Charter of Fundamental Rights, which was never part of retained EU law, but they also have an influence via the general principles, which can be used to interpret retained EU law. So that will go. Well, anything that's retained of retained EU law, which will become assimilated law, will not be subject to, will not include and not be subject to those general principles. So I suppose there is a potential issue there, although we do, of course, still have domestic human rights frameworks, which will continue to apply. I mean, the more general problem with the cliff edge is it's just absurdly short. I mean, it's ridiculous to expect that the entire body of well, it's not the entire body, but the everything that's subject to the Act can be reviewed and a sensible decision taken about its retention or amendment or replacement by the end of this year. I think that's just not going to happen.
Okay, what do you think will happen then?
Well, if the bill is passed, I think it will have to be, the deadline can be and it will have to be extended, but that is not within the control of this Parliament, it's within the control of UK ministers. And they could, they have the option to extend the deadline across the board or to extend the deadline for particular areas of law. So, I can't see a cliff edge at the end of this year. I just can't see it. It would just be ridiculous that, just because civil servants haven't managed to get through the work, bits of the statute book just disappear. That's ridiculous. So I don't think that will happen.
Okay.
Thank you. Ms. Minto?
Thank you, Convener, and thank you, Professor McHarg. It's been really informative, and thank you as well for your paper that you submitted as well. I've been listening to what you've said, and I was interested, I hope I'm not misquoting you, but that you implied that there was a need to amend the devolution statutes in a consensual manner. So I'm interested, given where we are, and we've had some evidence or suggestions that looking at taking back control didn't also meant fully taking back control to Westminster, and that could have changed the way of thinking with regards to devolution. In your report, in your paper, you have talked about changes taking place on an ad hoc, often rushed and largely non-consensual manner. So I'm interested to know how, given where we are just now, how you think we, the four parliaments, could move to amending the statutes in a consensual manner? Big question.
So I think the Brown Commission report provides an opportunity here. As you'll be aware, the Brown Commission has recommended quite significant reforms to devolution, including to the operation of the Sewell Convention, which is under consultation at the moment. As I understand it, I think that the Labour Party have talked about a taking back control bill, which is a nice bit of political theatre, by which they mean taking back control largely to the English regions, but also to to the devolved institutions in Scotland, Wales and Northern Ireland. Now, that provides an opportunity for the devolved parliaments, because as part of their commitment to reinvigorating SEWL, they are committed to doing that in a consensual and agreed manner. Now, if they really mean that, then that's an opportunity for this Parliament, for the Senate, for the Northern Ireland Assembly to say, well, if you want our consent, you know, here are our conditions. So I think there is that would provide an opportunity. Other than that, I mean, if Labour don't get into power after the next UK general election, it's much harder to see to see an opportunity. There may be other avenues.
That's helpful. I was going to ask as well, but you touched on it about the role of parliaments and the capacity that the devolved parliaments have. You noted what Professor McEwen said last week. Is there anything you want to expand on with regard to the capacity that we have as a parliament to scrutinise not only legislation that we want to pass that is appropriate for Scotland, but also scrutinising changes that Westminster are making that impact on us?
Well, your opportunity to do that is through the legislative consent process. And looking from the outside, that seems to work pretty well in this Parliament, certainly compared to how it might have operated in the past. So committees do take evidence, there are plenary debates, we get pretty full legislative consent memorandums and sometimes supplementary memorandums. If you compare that with what goes on in some of the other parliaments, the Northern Ireland Assembly, there was a committee report a year or so ago in which they complained that the Northern Ireland Executive doesn't always ask them for consent. And so their procedures really don't work all that effectively. The Welsh Parliament has also complained sometimes about the quality of engagement from the Welsh Government. Obviously the quality of the engagement you're able to have depends on time, and that will depend often on timescales at Westminster over which you have no control. There may be opportunities, perhaps, for more interparliamentary working. That's something that is often often raised. So, where UK Parliament committees are taking evidence or looking at bills, there may be opportunities for joint working there, or for at least more direct feeding in of views. But I haven't thought in detail about how those procedures might work.
Okay, thank you.
Just to note that I will be attending the Interparliamentary Forum tomorrow in Westminster going forward. Are there any supplementary? Ms. Boyack.
Thanks very much, Convener. It was just to continue the discussion about the SEWL Convention, and you mentioned the Brown Commission proposing statutory restatement of the Convention, and also the Scottish Government proposing statutory reform as well. And you also mentioned other statutory changes which could be brought in. And the idea behind that, you said, which I think is really interesting, that the application of UK legislation to devolve matters would have to be explicit, and failure to seek consent would be evidence that the relevant provisions were not intended to apply in devolved areas. So strengthening that principle and putting it on the statute, I think that's a really interesting way to go. And I think we have had past agreement on the need to update the devolution settlement, so I thought that was a very helpful comment about how you could practically strengthen the devolution settlement alongside strengthening the SEWL Convention.
Mm. Yeah, I mean, I did wonder, when SEWL was put on a statutory footing in the 2016 Act, you know, that sort of interpretive role was one way in which it might have had some sort of judicial teeth. You know, obviously there was always going to be issues around about direct enforcement. In the first Miller case, the Supreme Court said, well, we're not even going to get involved in interpreting it. But it could still have had some sort of interpretive function, but I don't think it has. You see in cases, you know, the statutory recognition of Sewell and the referendum law are sometimes referred to, but then they don't play any role in the decision-making process. So they kind of, they're there, but they're not doing any constitutional work, as it were, certainly not in the adjudicative sphere. So I think strengthening the statutory statements of Sewell could work. Now, what the Brown Commission has proposed is just to take out "not normally," so it becomes what looks like an absolute rule. But of course, it wouldn't be an absolute rule, because the enforcement would be via the House of Lords veto, revised second chamber veto. So the second chamber would, in effect, be deciding what was normal and what was not normal, and when, you know, when it was justified to depart from the convention or not. I don't think that's really good enough. I would rather see some more explicit set of exceptions to the Sewell Convention, and whether that's done on a statutory basis or through intergovernmental negotiation, you know, that's a question for discussion. But I think some sort of explicit understanding of when override is justified is better, because it's not normally thing. It's just far too vague. And we saw in the Brexit process, oh, Brexit's not normal, therefore no consent. Well, okay, Brexit wasn't normal, but that, you know, didn't mean that every single piece of Brexit-related legislation raised the same sorts of issues or had the same urgency or was being done against the same background of, you know, external obligations. In some cases, yes, but not in other cases. And just a sort of blanket invocation, oh, it's not normal, it's not good enough. You need some sort of clarification of what the principles are. And then, you know, obviously, there's still room for discussion about whether or not they apply in any particular case. But you've got a clearer understanding of when setting aside consent might be justifiable or not.
Yeah, that's really helpful. I think the not normally issues definitely come up in a lot of evidence. And I think your idea about a more explicit set of exceptions is interesting. And of course, that whole intergovernment negotiation, very interesting, as long as you have a degree of interparliamentary or accountability or transparency. Yeah. And that whole issue of stakeholders, which we discussed under the retained EU law issue. So yeah, That's really helpful. Thanks very much.
Yeah, sorry, just to come back on that. I mean, I think one of the weaknesses in the initial set of intergovernmental arrangements right back at the beginning of devolution and devolution guidance notes and so on, is there was very, very little parliamentary involvement. There was some in this parliament, there was none in the UK parliament, and I don't think you would want to replicate that again. You want buy-in from all four parliaments, but particularly the UK parliament. If this is the UK parliament subjecting itself to self-denying ordinances, it needs to know about them, it needs to acknowledge them, it needs to commit to them in an explicit way.
Thank you.
Okay, can I bring in Mr. Cameron, then Mr.
Just on your comment, very interesting comment about Sewell being a question for, you know, if the solution in the Brown report takes effect, Sewell being a matter for a second chamber, doesn't that just politicise it in a slightly different way? But it renders it a question of politics, and similarly, if you were to create conditions where, you know, Sewell was applied or not applied, doesn't that render it a matter for litigation and the courts?
So yes, the Brown Commission proposal does ultimately depend on politics to defend the devolved autonomy, and I've written about this when the report was first published, and that makes the composition of any new second chamber absolutely crucial, because if the devolved institutions are or the devolved territories are represented in proportion to population share, there's very little guarantee. Now, the assumption is that if you have more devolution in England, somehow that will kind of change the general constitutional mindset and they'll be more attentive to these kind of matters. But it seems to me there's no guarantees there. Brown does envisage a role for the courts. So they envisage a role for the courts in triggering the House of Lords veto. So there would have to be a reference to probably the Supreme Court, it's not specified, to, as it were, certify that the bill in question is one which engages the Second Chamber veto power. So it does give the courts a role, and I can see the case for that, because what we've seen over the past few years, not only, and you'll be well aware of this, not only instances of devolved consent or lack of consent being ignored, but also many, many more disputes about whether or not devolved consent is required at all. Now, sometimes it seems to be the UK government taking quite a narrow view of devolved consent. Sometimes it's the devolved legislatures taking a very expansive view of when devolved consent is required. At the moment, there is no way of authoritatively resolving those disputes. Miller 1, was an attempt, at least, to get the courts to say whether the EU, whether Article 50 legislation would engage the Sewell Convention, and they just said no. We're not going to touch it. So at the moment, you've got no way of authoritatively resolving those disputes, and that means by default the UK government's position prevails. So, you kind of got a double whammy there. You've got the UK government can undermine Sewell from two directions. One is by confining its scope, and the other is by being willing to legislate, even within scope, where it acknowledges the convention's engaged, by being willing to dispense with the requirement of consent. And I think both of those are problematic. I don't see how you can get an authoritative resolution of these problems, the scope problems, without involving the courts. The House of Lords Constitution Committee has said, well, Westminster parliamentary committees could perform that role, but they are political committees. The devolved are not directly represented before those committees. They could give evidence, but that would be it. And with the Brown Commission proposals as well, it requires the second chamber to trigger the reference to courts. There wouldn't, as far as I see, be any role for the devolved governments or devolved legislatures to trigger that reference procedure. So I think you would want to kind of widen that out a bit, because what you're talking here is about reassurance, the reassurance that comes from an independent adjudicator. And I think at least at that point of scope, that requires legal intervention.
Thank you. Good news for the lawyers then. Thank you. Thank you, Convener.
Dr. Allen.
Thank you. You've kind of touched on the question I was going to ask, but I'm just not sure I understand, genuinely not sure I understand how an upper house, a House of Lords, revised or otherwise, is going to find itself in a less contentious position, given that 90% of its members will not be from Scotland, or a good day, perhaps 80%, I'm not quite sure I understand how their decision as to whether Scotland's consent is required to something is going to be less contentious because the other 80 or 90% include people from English local authorities or regional authorities. I just don't understand how that would be a less contentious and difficult political situation.
I mean, I'm not sure that it would be less contentious. I think what the Brown Commission envisages is that the role of this revised second chamber would be very much more a constitutional role, and therefore the culture of the House, I suppose, would be more attuned to protection of constitutional matters. And we already see that in the current House of Lords. It does tend to be more interested in constitutional principle issues than the House of Commons does. But it's an unelected House, right? If you have an elected House and a weaker House, actually, because Brown proposes removing the House of Lords veto or delaying power in general, replacing it with a stronger veto power but removing its routine delaying power, it's not obvious to me that is a recipe for a more constitutionally vigilant second chamber.
Thank you.
I'm looking for any further questions from the committee. We just have a final observation. In part of the evidence, you talked about regional devolution for England and things, but part of the evidence we heard has been about that we will always have these particular issues as long as the UK legislature is performing a function for the whole of the UK at the same time as it is legislating for England and Wales in certain areas and for England in many more areas. Mm-hmm. Could you see this leading to a splitting of the UK function into a legislature for England so that it would be four devolved nations and then an overarching UK? Or do you think that's very much a longer, more unrealistic view? And how will devolution, whether it's through citywide or regional basis in England, impact on the very problems we're talking about just now when they have at the moment just the UK government?
So I don't think an English Parliament is a realistic prospect. And in a sense, it's not really the English Parliament you have to worry about, it's government, right? So that's where the problems stem from. It's that it's in Whitehall departments the failure to understand when they're acting with a UK hat or an England Wales hat. Because once it gets into the legislature, it becomes clear what the territorial extent of legislation is usually. And you, as we saw with EVIL, English Votes for English Laws, you can introduce procedures that separate out England-only legislation from UK or GB-wide legislation. But it's much harder to see how you do that at government level. And it's particularly difficult to see how you do that in circumstances where it really matters. In other words, where you have different English and UK-wide political majorities. Because you'd have to have two different governments. So I think it's just very difficult to solve that problem. Does more English regional devolution solve the problem? Well, as you know, the model of English regional devolution that is being pursued is a very, very different thing to devolution in Scotland, Wales and Northern Ireland. It is not legislative devolution. There are not separate representative assemblies. You've got directly elected mayors, but that's a different thing. So we're talking about a local government. We're talking about enhanced local government as opposed to the parcelling out of central government authority, which is what devolution does. Devolution creates institutions of central government with accompanying legislatures in the devolved nations, which English devolution at the moment is simply not attempting to do, and I've never seen any concrete proposals for legislative devolution in England. So I think while they continue to be different things, I don't think English devolution is a solution to the constitutional problems that the Scottish, Welsh and Northern Irish institutions face, which is not to say it's not worth doing. Of course, it tends to be perceived for different reasons in England. It's about decentralisation rather than a legitimacy problem, which is what drove devolution in Scotland in particular.
Yeah. And a very final question, sorry. My colleague, Ms Boyle, alluded to the visit that we had from the Constitution Committee from Saxony earlier this week. Are there models out there, albeit most countries have written constitution which you don't have, are there any other examples that we could take some best practice from in terms of dispute resolution and maybe looking at some of the committees that have been set up elsewhere and the mechanisms that are available elsewhere that might help going forward?
I mean, no doubt, and you can take negative lessons as well as positive lessons. Each constitutional set of arrangements is unique, and whether they are formally federal or not formally federal isn't necessarily as important in practice as it might appear in principle. So I'm going to leave you with a very general answer. I'm sure there are lessons you could take, but off the top of my head, I can't give you any more details and answer than that, sorry.
Okay, I think we've exhausted questions from the committee. So again, Professor McCarrick, thank you very much for both your written submission and your attendance at committee today. And we now move into private session. Thank you.
Thank you.